Please make your way to the performance area. No food and drink are allowed in the performance area. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello, good afternoon. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, our distinguished guests, especially for our beautiful people from top women in ASEAN. How are you guys today? Can we have a round of applause first to be Janjirikan today? Thank you. So once again, welcome to Jakarta. Welcome to At America. At America is an American cultural center where you can explore and experience about the United States, and you can share your ideas, your thoughts about America through our facilities and events that we held almost every day in here performance area. And here are the upcoming events in At America. So on October 28th, we're gonna have a Pink October. Through this event, you can learn what you can do to champion breast cancer research. And as we all know, on this October, we're gonna have a Halloween. It's a Halloween chat event in the afternoon. We can invite you and you can join through our cooking demo and enjoy screaming pasta with blood red raspberry sauce. Ooh, made by famous Indonesian chef. And in the same day, during that day, we provide you a special effect makeup artist so you can try your own scariest look. Sounds great, right? Okay, another facilities that we have in At America, what we call is Education USA, in the Education Corner. So if there's anyone who wants to study in the United States and maybe have a question how to get a scholarship in the United States, we provide you our facilitator. Her name is Fina and Caroline. They will be more help than help you to answer all of your questions about the education in the United States. At America has been here since December 2010. We have held over 3,200 events in such a various diverse of topic. As we know, we have seminar, a cooking demo, music and art, technology and environment. And how to get an update schedule event through our events in At America? It's very easy. You just go to the website www.atamerica.org.id, click register, put your name and email address, and we will give you our update schedule event through your email only once a week. And also, you can spread love about our today's event by using your Twitter. You can tweet using our hashtag @America, then your tweet will appear onto our tweet wall on the right side. Okay, sounds cool. Okay, a round of applause first for At America, thank you. And ladies and gentlemen, our distinguished guest to begin the event, I would like to welcome you. Please welcome Her Excellency Nina Hajikian, U.S. Ambassador to ASEAN, to do an opening remarks and today's moderator. Please welcome.
Selamat sore. Good afternoon, everybody. It is my true, deep pleasure to be with you here today for this Women Who Lead panel discussion. I've been looking forward to it all week, or actually really for months, because we have such a great group of leaders with us tonight for this discussion, and a wonderful audience as well. Over the last two decades, a strong body of research has emerged, and its findings are very clear. When women thrive, organizations thrive, and nations thrive. When girls and women are educated, and barriers to their best futures fall, companies are more profitable, communities prosper, governments make better choices, and economies grow. Countries where women are closer to enjoying equal rights are more economically competitive. Countries that repeal laws that discriminate against women and pass laws that promise equality see an increase in women joining the workforce and see a boost in their economic growth. Companies with more women who serve in senior management are proven scientifically to be more profitable. So as Beyonce sings, my persuasion can build a nation. And although in my lifetime there have been really important significant advances for women, including the fact that a woman is a major party candidate for the U.S. presidency for the first time ever, There is still a lot of work to be done so that every girl and every woman can live up to her potential. So that is why two of my top priorities as the U.S. Ambassador to ASEAN are to cultivate young leaders and to promote opportunities for women. And today's event, I hope, will do both. In the audience today are 40 young women attending the U.S. ASEAN Women's Leadership Academy for YC Lee. This is a program that the President Obama announced in Laos last month. The group includes representatives from all 10 ASEAN member states and were selected to participate in this interactive workshop to build their leadership skills. For any of you in the audience who are not familiar with YC Lee, it stands for the Young Southeast Asia Leadership Initiative, Leaders Initiative, and it's the U.S. government's signature program to strengthen leadership, development, and networking in Southeast Asia. Through a variety of programs, including trips to the United States, regional workshops, and small grants, YC Lee builds leadership capacity of young people, strengthens ties with the United States, and fosters an ASEAN community. YC Lee will be 3 years old this December and has now almost 100,000 self-selected members from all 10 ASEAN countries. If you're not yet a member, it's very easy to become one. Just go to the website, it's yclee.state.gov, and sign up. YC Lee is open to all residents of ASEAN who are between the ages of 18 and 35, and you can sign up here as well at America after this program. Today's panel represents a very impressive group of leaders. They have tons of experience, and I'm confident that their advice will be useful to you. We also are going to want to hear a little bit from you, so after we have a conversation here on the stage, we'll open the floor to comments and questions. The goal of the panel is not to be a self-contained event, but rather to fuel conversations on how to increase women's participation in leadership roles. So I hope that all of you as well are thinking about and focused on your own potential to be future women leaders or how you can support future women leaders. So if you want to tweet or blog or post, you can use the hashtag YCLeeWomen, so Y-S-E-A-L-I women. Now I would like to introduce our impressive group of panelists and invite them to join me on the stage. Deborah Maggett is the Director of Software Strategy at IBM Venture Capital Group. Deborah is a frequent spokesperson on topics of relevance to entrepreneurs and investors. She is chair of the board of the SV Forum, the Silicon Valley Emerging Technology Network, and on the steering committee of the California Sustainability Alliance. Previously, Deborah held positions in product management, marketing, and user-centered design at Telligent, GE Information Services, and AT&T. Deborah holds degrees in cognitive psychology from the University of Pennsylvania and the University of Connecticut. Welcome to Deborah. Thank you. Mujaja has been the director of the Gajah Tungul Group since 2004. Prior to that, Kath worked for various multinational companies, including HSBC Indonesia and Deutsche Bank AG in Jakarta. She received a Master's of Science in Control Engineering from the University of Bradford and graduated in Mathematics and Computer Science from Sheffield Polytechnic and Leeds Polytechnic in the UK. Kath is also a managing director of Alun-Alun Indonesia, an Indonesian retail concept which promotes Indonesian products and artisans. She is also active in HIV/AIDS prevention and was instrumental in setting up the Indonesia Business Coalition on AIDS as well as the Indonesia Business Coalition on Women Empowerment. Welcome, Kathy. Arya Vida Purnamasari is the corporate communication leader of General Electric, or GE, in Indonesia. Vida also leads GE Digital Communications Activities for ASEAN and the GE Women Network for Indonesia. She has 16 years of experience in corporate communications and advertising in various sectors such as technology, multilateral organization, management consulting, and hospitality sectors. She is the mother of two and an avid CrossFitter, who has competed in several competitions across the region. Vita holds a Master's of Business Administration from Monash University in Australia and a Bachelor of Science in Hotel and Restaurant Management from Pennsylvania State University in the United States. Welcome. And last but not least, Noviar Adiani leads the Wildlife Conservation Society Indonesia program as the country director. She completed her PhD in conservation biology at the University of Indonesia, where she also served as a lecturer for the past 20 years. She was the head of graduate program in conservation biology at the same university when she joined the Wildlife Conservation Society Indonesia program. Outside of these two institutions, Yani also chairs the Indonesian Primatological Association and one of the key contributors to the National Strategy for Orangutan Conservation. Welcome, Yani. Jump right in. I will start by asking each of you a question, but of course you're all free to chime in on any of these questions. So let me start with you, Deborah. What do you think is one skill or characteristic that's essential for a good leader?
So there are a lot of things that go into being a leader, but before you can do any of those things really well, you have to have confidence. You need to be able to trust yourself. You need to be able to speak out, whether it's in a meeting or trying to sell your product to customers or hiring employees. You have to be able to go to our reception after this talk and mingle with the people and say hello and tell them who you are. And you can't do those things unless you have confidence and trust in yourself.
Let me ask you a question, or maybe some of you. Can you pretend to have confidence if you don't have it?
Yes, you certainly can, because I was a very shy child, and I was, actually I'm still a little bit shy, which you might find hard to believe. I don't like walking into a room full of strangers and drinking wine and trying to work the room. I just don't like to do it, but I do it. So you can teach yourself, and you can do it in several ways. You can practice pitching, you can go to these receptions and just make yourself do things, you can role play with a friend. So it's something that may not be in your heart all the time, but you can act like you're confident, and you can show confidence, which is almost the same thing as having it in your heart. And actually, a lot of things that you can do over time, if you practice them and actually do them when you're out and about, they become part of you, and then you do have confidence.
What about the rest of you? Any other skills or characteristics you think are important for...
I think you also have to be having a discipline. Yeah, I think discipline is very important as a leader. Discipline in terms of very small things like time management. You know, I think I can speak for myself as an Indonesian. I think that's something that we tend to sort of like take it for granted. You know, excuse like traffic jam. I mean, the traffic jam is always going to be there. So you know, to be disciplined in little things, and I think you know, you set an example for your staff, your subordinates on that, then I guess that will achieve whatever you want to do to be disciplined in your work.
I think also what's important about being a leader is that the leader has to be able to develop other leaders, because in order for us to foster growth, in order for us to grow the organization, we have to be able to grow leaders within the organization so that we can also move up within the organization. That's I think one thing that one of the tasks or one of the qualities that leaders should have, in addition to, you know, coaching and being a role model and having discipline and having the confidence to lead and also to inspire other people in the organization.
I think to all these characteristics that have been described, presented by my wonderful panelists, colleagues here, I think I would like to add to the ability to listen to the others. I think sometimes we forget, I do, that not being kind of the boss in the office, that I tend to just listen to myself and then force the others to listen to me. But it's good. you know, for once in a while that you give the, you know, you give yourself the time just to really listen to what the other person has to say.
So Kath, I'll start with you for this question. If you could look back at your 25-year-old self and give yourself a piece of advice back then, what would you say to yourself now?
I think I would like to be more curious, to actually, sort of like not, I mean, I was an engineer as a background, and I tend to say that that's my destiny, you know, to be a scientist and so on. But the reality is when I come back to Indonesia, it's just very difficult for a female to get into the engineering field at the time, back in the 80s, early 80s. So I decided, because my first degree was mathematics and I thought numbers, then I decided just out of the blue, I applied to all the banks here, multinational banks, with my, you know, knowledge in the mathematics. Then I got it. So I thought that that's something, you know, you do not have to stick to whatever you studied in whatever fields that you do. You can actually expand, because I think, the education that you take in the university, it is actually setting you foundations, not only because of the knowledge, but also the networking that you get from the university to get to know people and get that confidence. And then that's it, you know, it's as you go and work, you can find the passion, the whatever that your inner self that you want to do at that time. So I thought maybe if I be more curious, I could be maybe something else by now.
I think I'm a good example of what you just described. I have a biology undergraduate degree. So. Others of you who give advice to your younger selves?
Yeah, I think if I could go back and give advice to my 25-year-old self would be to be more of a risk taker, and it's okay. It's okay to make mistakes because it's part of learning, it's part of growth. And so I think it's part of our self growth as well, to be able to learn from your mistakes and then adapt to the situations.
I had the same thought about what Sul had done when I was at that. I could back to my younger self. I think to be bold and brave, and then you know, afraid to make mistakes. Because I believe mistake is really the best teachers in the world. I was trained as a conservation geneticist, and then when I was in the labs, I was told by my supervisors that everything I touch is very expensive, and then you know everything can ruin in a minute. So I always had couldn't sleep the night before every time I have to do some experiments. But then I learned, you know, the world is not falling apart if I just drop one or two tubes. So there you go. Be brave. I think so.
It's okay to drop those tubes.
So I'm a psychologist. I don't have a degree in tech, and I don't have a degree in business. And I have the same thought that Kath had, which is, you know, once I graduated with a degree in cognitive psychology, what was I going to do with that? And there were limited things you could do. So I started out in education, you know, teaching school teachers how to interpret tests that their kids were taking. And I really didn't think about doing other things until later when somebody offered me a job at AT&T in tech. It fell in my lap, but I wasn't looking around to think of other things that I might do. And I learned later in life that what I studied in school was something that very few people ever cared about. They cared that I had a degree, they cared that I went to a good school, and they cared that I did well, but they really did not care that I had that specific degree, and if I had known that earlier, I might have moved onward to something else sooner.
All right, Yanni, what do you think, starting with the new question, is the most significant barrier to women leaders today?
Well, I think we need to admit that we still, up to now, although we are now living in the 21st century, but we still live in a male-dominated world. In my fields, where in environments. I'm working for WCS, Wildlife Conservation Society, trying to protect the environment and all the species inside. Most of my colleagues are males, and in all these meetings or all these negotiations, I think it's very often that I'm the only woman. And then for me to be heard of this very, sometimes a very, quite noisy space, is difficult. But then the other thing that I found is quite challenging is to balance. You know, at one point we need to still present ourselves as women with all this womanness that we have. You know, the kindness, the tenderness, soft voice. But then on the other hand, we need also to present ourselves as, you know, as a strong person. I think as a woman, we need to work sometimes twice or three times harder than men to get to where we are. And then in all this forum, we need to not to shout, but to be heard in a certain way, whereas we still, you know, keep against our femaleness, our womanness, but to take be taken seriously. Sometimes I feel that my old male colleagues in this old forum, they are nice to me because because it's just one of the persons in all this group. But I don't want to be taken just nicely. I want to be taken seriously, and that's, I think, can be still a challenge, still up to now.
Others?
Yeah, I think that's the same. I think the challenge is us being a woman. That is the challenge. And they're always, you know, we are judged by our emotion rather than by, you know, sometimes by our skills. So some, like Nofi said, you know, I mean, it's okay if she is, make mistake, she's a woman, but the guy is not being, you know. And then, oh, if we get emotion, oh, it's because she is a woman, she get emotion. But sometimes the guys also can be as nasty. So I think the challenge is us being a woman. We just have to, as Nofi said, we have to act that, you know, in the man's world, how to behave and things like that. We are judged by that.
And we have stereotypes to overcome, and sometimes the stereotypes are our own. So we have to understand that women can be heard and our voices can be heard and we can be in a man's world. And we also have to understand that women can have any kind of job that they want to have. How many people know who the CEO of IBM is? Virginia Rometty. This woman runs a $80 to $90 billion revenue company with 380,000 employees that operate in every country in the world we're allowed to do it. And there are women CEOs of mining companies, energy companies, construction firms, Pepsi's. Do you drink Pepsi? Pepsi's CEO is a woman, General Motors. So there are women who are very talented, very serious, very powerful leaders who have made their way in the world because they will not be stopped.
And I just want to repeat what I said in the opening, that a study that just came out from the Peterson Institute, a very prestigious economic think tank in Washington, D.C., which surveyed 22,000 companies in 91 countries and found that the companies with more senior women in management positions were more profitable. I mean, it's just, you know, go figure.
I also agree with Deborah. Sometimes, I mean, I agree that there are some stereotypes from external about women, but also some of the time the stereotypes are coming from our own. As a product of our education, as a product of how we are brought up. I mean, how many times you've heard the panel, how many times the word about being more risk-taker, about being more brave has come up from us. That's also part of our education as well, that women are expected to be perfect before they can come out, where it's not okay for women to make mistakes. That's why before we even say anything, we have to think like 2-3 times before we ask the questions, before we present an idea, for example. Whereas I think part of part of learning and part of brainstorming, part of creating innovation, I think all employees or everyone in their organization have to be more risk taker, that includes both women and men, have to be more, you know, brave in exploring ideas and solutions.
Okay, so that's a key message for you all to take away. So you're as good, so go ahead and take risks. And that's also been shown in studies that women tend to underestimate their talent and abilities, and men tend to overestimate their talent and abilities. Not true of everybody, but in general, that's what studies show. So Vida, can you talk about a person who's had a significant impact on you as a leader and why?
I think for every daughter, I think our first role model will be our mothers. I think it's pretty easy because, you know, she's the one who's been taking care of us since we were little. But I think for my mom, she's particularly ahead of her time at that time. It was in the early 80s, and she was working in an IT company, which was very few at that time. And she had a very good career, which was kind of frowned upon at that time. But she persevered, and then she really believed in herself that she could make a difference, both outside of home and in at home. So because of that, I still admire her for what she did then and for what she's doing now. And of course, throughout my career development, my work experience, I do encounter other leaders in the previous companies and in the current companies that I work for. So it's part of the learning process as well.
My first role model was actually my father, but I'm not going to talk about him. I wanted to use an example that's a good lesson for other women, because women tend not to stick up for themselves and negotiate well. You don't ask for raises, we don't negotiate when we get a new job, we accept often what is given to us. So my best friend at GE, and I worked there quite a few years ago, was coaching me when I got offered a job in California with an IBM joint venture, which is how I ended up at IBM. And I was living outside Washington, D.C., which is not the most expensive place in the country. Silicon Valley is the most expensive place in the country. And he said, you have to ask them to double your salary. I said, you're crazy, double it? I can't ask them to make it twice as much as I make now. He said, no, you have to, this is your mantra. Double my salary, double. He actually did this to me, double my salary. I thought, what do I have to lose? You have to have a fallback position. You have to know what you're going to say when they say no. So I asked them to double my salary, and I told them why, so I had a reason, and they said yes. And then I said, I'm going across the country from Washington to California. I don't have enough vacation time. I need more holiday time so I can have a holiday and visit my friends and family. So I asked them to double that as well. And they said yes. So that is my advice to you from my friend David.
Thank you, David. Sorry.
Changed my life.
Back to your statement that sometimes we underestimate ourselves, that you have to be brave enough to ask. If
you need the confidence.
You don't get it, right?
Others who have role models they want to talk about?
Well, I think I would like to add to what Deborah and Vida said. I think I would like to refer to my father as my role models. I think, he taught me kindness and tolerance. I think this is important. I grew in a very small town in somewhere in one island in east coast of Sumatra. You know, you cannot find my birth town in the map. So we lived in a very close community. But at the time, he allowed me, when I was still a very small girl, to sit among his friends and then his brothers and his sisters. We love talking about politics at that time. Of course, the state of the affairs of the city at that time. I found this very fascinating. But you know, for me, it was a big deal. And then I learned how to present my arguments, to argue. And then we live in a very democratic family. It's quite rare in our society. So, and the other thing is about tolerance. This is something that I'd like to remember and to bring to these forums now in Indonesia. Well, I don't want to talk about politics, but we live in a very religious country. We admit that we are religious people, but I don't think we live in a religious life. And one lesson, my father is the head of the community mosque until the end of his day. one thing he said to me, you know what, you just need to take one lesson from the Quran. This is lakum dinukum waliyadin. For you, your religion is for me is mine. So there you go. So you know, he's really a wonderful person that, and I like to live up in his morals, but not really up to this point, but still use him and his wise wisdoms to live my life.
This can be from any of you, or maybe I'll start with you, Deborah. What do you think was the best decision that you made to move your career forward?
It was a silly thing, and my husband helped me make it. I was, I thought I had to do certain things when I got out of college, so I was working in education for the state of Connecticut, and a girlfriend offered me a job with AT&T out of the blue, and I was, my mind was over there with education, but it was a kind of a dead-end job. It wasn't going to go anywhere, and it didn't pay much, and the hiring manager was calling me while I was on holiday at my friend's home to ask if I was going to take the job at AT&T or not. And the phone was ringing, and my husband said, are you going to take that job? And I said, I don't think so. He said, yes, you are. And the phone rang, and I picked it up, and I said, yes, I will take the job. And that was the best decision I ever made, because it got me in a whole different career path. I started working in tech. I moved from, I was a psychologist, so I was doing design and, you know, usability engineering and things like that. Then I moved into marketing, and I moved into marketing communications, then I moved into business development, and now I travel around the world meeting with venture capitalists and people in that community, and I would never have this awesome job if I hadn't said yes at that moment.
For me, it's moving from a multinational companies that I have worked for to a national company. You know, I just took things for granted when I worked in the Deutsche Bank and HSBC. Everything is properly set, you know, the system is there. So when I decided that it's time for me to dedicate my, you know, my expertise to a local company, that was a challenge. And I joined a year before the crisis, so I thought to myself, you know, what have I done? But I learned. I think that was the great lessons. I mean, that I, you know, I actually went through the ups and downs and up. So I thought that was a, I think it was a good decision, so that now I could actually share what I have learned in the multinational into the national company, in particular to set the system right.
I think for me, going back to a multinational company is definitely the best decision I've ever done. So I started my career in Arthur Andersen, multinational company, and then I moved to a local PR firm, and then I had my first child, so then I thought, you know, maybe I should quit my job. So then I started working on a freelance basis, tried to set up a business here and there, but didn't work out. It definitely was not my calling. And then I got a call from the IFC, which is part of the World Bank Group, and then so I decided to join IFC. So I think that's one of the best decisions I've ever made, going back to corporate life and then multinational companies.
Well, I only have two jobs in my entire life. Before I joined WCS, well, up till now, I'm still a lecturer at University of Indonesia. So when I came back from completing my master's, I just wanted to be a scientist. I want to publish local papers. My subject is evolutionary biology. So my idea at that time is to map all the chromosomal evolution in all the birds in this country, something like that. So I have no care whatsoever to other than doing that. But then, you know, the idea of biodiversity conservation and doing conservation, working with the community, started to get into the circles of our communications and then our discussions. So, and I thought it's just a neat thing to do, you know, trying to save this planet. So I guess in 2003. So I met the former of the previous director of WCS, and then he offered me, you know, a job as a vice director at that time. So I said, well, why not? So and I think, yeah, I've been enjoying my works in WCS. Every time I am in the field visiting our field programs, since I haven't seen the tigers, so one of the species that we're working with tigers, I'd like to see the tigers. But seeing the elephants and then the malus, this is a very unique birds in North Sulawesi, thriving in their habitats, I think it gives me such joy. So to me, working in conservation area is really the best job I can have.
It sounds to me like one possible commonality in all those stories is sort of each of the leap. You know, a leap to something unknown, a big change, something maybe wasn't so clear that it was the right thing right at the beginning and may have felt a little bit nervous about it, but still, you know, put yourself forward to do it. So, all right, I'm going to ask one last question of the panel, and then it will be your turn. So get your questions ready or your comments. So let's start with you, Vita. Do you have any tips on how to balance work and life priorities in order to be successful? Both.
I think it depends on yourself on how do you manage your time, because if you expect the company to give you work-life balance, it will never happen. So you really have to set yourself, you know, I want to spend this much of time in my work, this much of time, you know, with my kids. I mean, sometimes like within the 12 hours or within the, you know, 12, 18 hours, you just have to concentrate on your work, which is sometimes inevitable, but you replace, you know, your time with your family some other time. So it really depends on how you manage your time. And sometimes you do have to make some sacrifices, but it's part of life. You got to make your choices.
I think that's absolutely true. One of my mentors was a man named Steve Mills, who ran $40 billion worth of IBM's product business, but he was also the sponsor of my dog. And he grew orchids, and he skied, and he played golf, and he was also a cabinet maker. His dad made furniture, and he knew how to do woodworking, and he built a whole library in his house. I said, how do you ever, you know, run this business and do that? He doesn't sleep as much as I do, but the answer was, I make the time for it. Friday afternoons, I do these things. And so that taught me that you have to just say, I'm going to do this, and make the time. And the other thing I'll say is, I was in Myanmar last week running a session for women, and there was a man in the audience who asked me that question. And I said, well, you know, someday, he said, the woman has to get breakfast and take care of the kids and then make dinner and take care of the house. I said, why? You know, you're going to have a family someday. You're asking me this question. Why don't you make the breakfast? Why don't you help with the children? And the audience all laughed because they hadn't really thought of it that way. But it's true. There are men in this audience. I hope you're all helping your wives and your families do these things.
I think, yeah, that would be perfect, right?
Wouldn't that be?
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
It's different in some societies. If you're in Sweden, they do it.
Yeah, even in Indonesia, you know, culture comes in. You know, as much as you would like to divide your time perfectly, but there's always culture elements in it that you know, especially in Asia in particular, and in Indonesia, women is expect to, you know, put the family higher than the job. Yeah, your husband should be higher than your boss. So, I mean, despite that, we're going into the modernism and everything, you know, open-minded and everything, there's always that. But it's up to you how to handle it, you know. I'm very lucky that my husband is fully supported in what I'm doing. But in a way, I also have to respect him for the time that he's given to me. So I set the priority that weekend is a no-no for any calls in regards to work. That's my rule. Of course, there's something that I have to bend it, you know. Because you are there and the top management, they can't wait until Monday until I make a decision. So, but yeah, respect comes in too, and it's just up to you how to divide. I mean, of course, the perfect way will be 50-50, but at the end, you yourself will know how much you can commit to your job and to the family. But as long as you respect each other, to the family, to your husband, to your, you know, your kids, and your work, I think that can be achievable in a way.
Well, I think I just want to add one thing. So my life since many years ago, it's been always surrounded by deadlines. And then at the old times, but now I learned that missing one or two deadlines is fine. It's really fine. I mean, the world is not falling apart if you just get away from work 1 or 2 days or a few hours. Give yourself the time. To me, it's really important. So, and then the time for us, for friends, for families, or for just me time, cannot be scheduled in our agenda because we cannot make it. So you have to make it. If you put it in your schedule, you cannot find any slot for that thing. So you just need to make it.
Learn to say no.
I actually have a funny story. I remember I was taking a vacation with my kids. We were in Universal Studios, and then I had to take a call because there's a crisis communication situation that I had to take care of. And then we were waiting in line for a ride in Universal Studios. And then by the time that we had to go on the ride, I just have to hang up the phone. And then everybody thought, "Are you okay?" Yeah.
Okay, so thank you. I've learned a lot. Thank you all. But now it's your turn to ask questions. Does anybody wants to be the first? Yes, right here. If you raise your hand, the friendly Ad America staff will bring you a microphone.
I'm Zin. I'm from Myanmar. My question, I have two questions. The first question is, I lead a team of 8 people. I run a travel agency back in my country. And I was actually, I graduated from Singapore. So whatever that I have learned is actually what has been practiced in Singapore. So I came back home after all the changes happened. So, but the thing is that, like you said, discipline is very important and stuff. So most of my expectations for our work, for the employees, is always there's their work. But then I don't want to negotiate it down for the convenience of my employee. But sometimes I come off very unkind to my employees, but I know that what I want is actually achievable. So there are times that in our community, especially in Myanmar, like how do you balance kindness and your standards, you know, and your ambitions and stuff? That was my first question. The second question is I come from a very Burmese family, but then most of my families are doctors. I'm the only person who is doing business. And when I first came back from Singapore, I had the cultural difference in my country with my own family. It's a lot easier to negotiate and do give and takes with the partner because your partner is actually at the age of, you know, the same age. And I want to know how do you have handled with the older generation when you know that what you're saying is right, but they have, and then you've been trying to explain, but there was one point I realized that my mom, being a doctor, she only thought things about great things in doctors, and she cannot appreciate what I have achieved. She will not understand things, even the, you know, that kind of, she will still tell me to wear long jeans, even though I know that my security as a citizen, as a woman, should not depend on what I'm wearing today.
Thank you. Those are two great questions. So
I'll answer the first one. Managers have to be fair, but they don't necessarily have to be loved. So the things you ask your employees to do have to make sense to them, And one way they can make sense is because you explain it. Another way it can make sense is if you include them in some of the decisions and they help with the decisions. But it's not about being nice. It's about being fair and honest and open about what you have them do.
Yeah, I think if you set your KPI, right, and...
KPI?
The, you know, your
measurements.
Measurement on your achievement. I mean, of course, we cannot be so strict, yeah? Otherwise, they will be so tense and the work is not done. You know, I understand what you mean. In my, what I'm doing is that I'm having an open door kind of a management, you know, sort of like anytime they can come in, and we have to be, giving empathy. There are some times that you have to be kind, but you know the time that you don't have to be kind. You know, work is work, and target's still a target. Unless if it's an emergency, of course, we cannot just say that, of course, you know, you cannot go home because your son or daughter is sick. There is a way to handle that. But then they have to catch up with it, you know, in order to achieve the target. You know, in your second questions, I think we're the same, you know. I actually went to overseas to do my study in the 70s, you know. So when I come back in the mid-80s, you know, I don't have any friends anymore because my parents sent us when we were small. So it's actually the culture shock for me. It's not within the family because, you know, my parents quite, you know, broad-minded. And even though they were not educated overseas, but they're quite, you know, open about it. But the culture shock comes from the friends that I used to study together in the elementary or high school. They find that I'm sort of like, you know, weird or, you know, too eccentric and things like that. And then I decided that I have to put myself low. You know, I have to blend. It's just actually come from you. It's not expecting them to change. I have to change myself to actually forget about what I have learned overseas and blend myself to the culture that I'm back now. You know, otherwise, it's just that you are frustrated because you cannot be part of them, and they think that I'm such a bossy people, or, you know, so snobbish, do not want to be, you know, be part of them anymore. So I'm afraid us ourselves, we have to change to that.
My parents really did not understand what I do for a living. They didn't think it was crappy, but they didn't understand it. And when I did resign from my job at GE and moved across the country, which is far away from them, and my mother, it wasn't because I was going far away, it was because I quit a nice job. She cried. She just wept because she did not understand it. And my husband said, Ma, she's in tech. Everybody does this. And so what I had to do for my parents was give them examples of people who were successful doing similar things and why this was a good path to be on, because they didn't understand, so I had to explain it.
Yeah, same with me. My parents don't understand why I have to travel so much, and then they also don't understand the line of work that I do. But again, you really have to give examples and demonstrate, you know, who are the people who are successful in your line of business, and hopefully they will understand. But then I always believe that parents act in, they think that they know best for the, you know, for the benefit of their children. So you also have to respect that, and then just, you know, try to give them examples that, you know, you are going to be okay being in this industry or doing the work that you do, as opposed to doing what they do. And with, you know, giving targets to employees and your team member, I also believe that one of the job of a leader is to inspire and empower their team member. So in order for you to make them want to do or to meet the target that you are setting them, you also have to make them believe that they can do more than they believe they can. So it's part of the inspiring and trying to empower your team member.
My mother was a teacher, so this is very proud when I becomes a teacher at the university. But then when I changed slightly the directions of my work. See, up to now, she couldn't understand what actually what I'm doing. Whenever I come home, you know, she always says to our neighbors, I do not understand why she has lots of t-shirts, you know, saints, the orangutan, the tigers, the elephants, all her t-shirts, you know, because she took care of my laundry when I'm home still, up to now. So, and then, you know, she said, I didn't understand why all your t-shirts have these pictures, you know, the orangutans, the tigers, and what actually I do. But then, whenever she saw me, sometimes in the newspapers or in I got interviewing TV or I got the chance to travel almost quite some part of the world. She kind of got it, and then she becomes impressed the idea that I'm doing something not the rest of the community where we live doing. And then for your questions, I think I would like to go with their peers. I think being fair, I think this is one of the key, and then being open with that. It's sometimes it's hard, to be kind all the times, but I don't like the idea of the people that I work with, because we are, working in that area. Conservation is really a work about patience. It's very difficult to have this kind of people. So I don't like the idea that they hit me because it's kind of. But again, the target is a target. We do have a target, and we need to also to be accountable to whatever support, financial support we receive to do our work. So I think being fair.
Sounds like you're not alone in having confused parents. Okay, I think we have time for about two more questions, and then after this we'll have some refreshments and we can, have more discussion sort of informal. I'm going to go with this side of the room this time. We have right here. Glasses.
Hi, good evening everyone. My name is V from Laos. Thank you, the panelists, for sharing your advice and your experience. I would like you guys to share more on the corporate world when you're on the table negotiating, and you would like to be taken more seriously, because being a woman or only woman in the room, it's a bit difficult to get your point across.
I actually never see that. I want to make sure that they don't see me as a female or male, yeah? I mean, when you come to the negotiations, it's a matter of how you handle it. I don't see it that I'm a female that I have to handle it differently. No. So don't have that fear. And that's what Deb said. Have confidence. It's you, It's not judging that you are girl or, boy. It's you. You just have to know what you are fighting for, what you are negotiating for. Have that. That's very important, because without that, we cannot negotiate, whether it's a female or male.
Yeah, being in a big corporation, some corporations, actually helps. So I'm in tech. There aren't very many women. I work with venture capitalists and investors. There are fewer women. But I work for IBM, and I'm an executive at IBM. And so when I go out to meet with these people, I have some weight of authority because of what I do and how I do it, not because I'm a woman. And I'll just tell you one really quick story. There was a very senior executive. He became a senior vice president reporting to our CEO. He became our chief strategist. His name was Rod Adkins, and he was black. And he was on stage at a conference in Europe, and the moderator was interviewing him and said, "What is it like to be, a black engineer and a senior executive at IBM?" He said, "I have no idea. I just do my job."
I mean, it's true that there may be additional barriers, but I think the message is, if you don't have confidence, at least try to fake confidence and be bold and be true to what you're trying to do and have a deep sense of that.
Okay, another question.
Hello, I'm Kinchit from Myanmar, and I'd like to raise a question that, according to the generation gap that we have in Myanmar, as I define myself as a leader for my junior, our co-workers, that for as a librarian and activist in Myanmar, in my community, I have to work with my senior teachers, who were my teachers when I was young. So it's hard to it's easier to empower my junior and my future generations, but for me itself, as a student of my senior leaders, I don't know how to empower them. As I feel like I'm too bossy for them, or they define me as why she become how can I say overactive of influence them to become being a good leader, but I was their student once. So I don't know how to appeal their situation to get into giving them empowerment, being good leaders for our community. So we have to collaborate regardless of we are different age.
I think earlier someone said about listening. Yeah, you did. I think that's very important. Because no matter what, in ASEAN, that culture comes in, that you have to respect your elders. So I think the way that you respect, you just listen, you know? And then after that, you find a time that you express what you think that should be done. You know, you cannot just immediately say that, no, you know, you have to change this, but you have to listen to them first. Give them the respect. You know, no matter what, we cannot avoid that. That's the culture. So you will be there. So don't have that fear also that, you know, but then don't be so snobbish too that you have that knowledge, you know, you're younger. You have to respect them and listen to what they want to say. Then you have find a time, you express what you think that should be done right.
I had to deal with a colleague who was more senior than me when I was at AT&T. And he thought he knew everything, and he did not want to cooperate. And I found out that he was a photographer, and I asked to see his photographs, and I took him to lunch, and I tried to form a relationship. I wasn't his best friend, and we weren't dating, but I tried to get to know him a little bit better and treated him almost like a customer. So when you know what makes those people successful, and you help make them successful, and you know something about them, then your relationship will change a bit.
Well, I think we could go on all night. I would like to go on all night, but our time is over. So those of you who have your hands up and have questions, please stay afterwards. We have a little reception, and panelists will be around at least for some time to try to answer them. And meanwhile, let's give them a big round of applause.
So ladies and gentlemen, once again, give round of applause for all the panelists and moderators. Thank you. And as our tradition, in America, would like to invite you to come up in the middle of the stage. We'll take a picture with the logo of America. So again, on behalf of America, would like to say thank you for your attendance. Thank you once again, and have a good day. So once again, all the participants would like to invite you to come and join with all the panelists and moderator onto the stage. We'll take a picture.